Today, we are going to review emergence and the recovery phase of general anesthesia. So come along as we wake up our patient from general anesthesia. So just a review, general anesthesia is a drug-induced loss of consciousness. And there are five goals to general anesthesia: the amnesia, no memory recall, hypnosis, they're going to be unconscious, and analgesia, we want them to be pain-free, and then muscle relaxation and reflex control. Reminder, there are four physiological phases of general anesthesia. There's the sedation phase, the excitation delirium phase, the surgical phase, and then the overdose phase. Today, as we talk about emergence and recovery, we are going to be watching as our patients go from a surgical level of general anesthesia, then they will come up through the delirium emergence phase and then become at a sedated phase as they recover and come back through consciousness. So there are four phases of anesthesia: the induction, the maintenance, the emergence, and the recovery. During phase one, you will be dealing with emergence and recovery phases of general anesthesia. So the emergence phase, which is the phase three of general anesthesia, this is when the anesthesia gas is weaned off by the anesthesiologist. They usually do it gradually during the beginning of the closing of the surgery. And then they begin to give reversals for the neuromuscular blocking agents, the paralytics. So the vecuronium, the rocuronium, they will give either neostigmine or sugammadex. Sugammadex, you do need to be aware of that if your patient does have it, that if they're on birth control pills, that it will not be effective for 1 week. So that needs to be included in discharge teaching. Also during this phase, during the reversal phase, for emergence, they will give an analgesic, usually some fentanyl. They will also give an antiemetic, usually Zofran, and usually some dexamethasone. So as the patient begins to awaken, their neuromuscular blockade will be weaned off. They'll have a 4 out of 4 on their train of 4, and they will begin to awaken and resume their protective reflexes like their gag and their cough and their swallow. Remember, as they go from the surgical phase of anesthesia, they come up through delirium excitement phase. And during this phase, you can have emergence delirium where the patient is confused. This can last anywhere from 15 to 45 minutes. It is seen more with our patients who receive ketamine. So you don't want to stir up those patients who've had ketamine. You just want them to be undisturbed. The only time you would disturb them is if you have a respiratory compromise. Our younger patient populations will have more confusion, the pediatrics. And then also just remember, patients with a history of post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, they can definitely have more of a delirium emergence. So we usually have extra staff at the bedside when we know about those patients, just so we can provide safety for them. And when they wake up, just remind them, reorient them where they are, what happened, that they are safe. I can't stress that enough. It just, they need to know that they are safe and that they are going to be fine and that this will all pass, and just continue to reorient them. And then there's the recovery phase. This is when the patient has regained consciousness in the PACU and you're maintaining pain control, getting them back to their baseline with their hemodynamics. Some of our patients, anesthesia, will choose to do what we call a deep extubation. And I just want to go over a deep extubation because this is there's a lot of fear around deep extubation if they don't fully understand what deep extubation is. And so deep extubation is when the anesthesiologist removes the endotracheal tube before their gag reflex has returned while the patient is still under deep sedation. So what they will do is they will, while the endotracheal tube is in, they will put in an oral pharyngeal airway. And then they will suction out the mouth and the upper oropharynx area, and then they will remove the endotracheal tube. And the goal of doing a deep extubation is to minimize coughing and gagging the irritation that comes with having someone awake with the tube through their vocal cords. So this is desired when surgery is done with ear, nose, and throat patients, tonsillectomy patients, pediatric patients. The head of the bed is going to be raised. It's going to help promote lung expansion. Their head will be tilted slightly to the side to keep it open from the tongue obstructing. And there will be an oral airway in. And upon arrival to the PACU, when you have somebody who's deeply extubated with an oral airway in, but still totally unresponsive to sternal rub, remember, their reflexes are absent, their cough and their gag. So airway is number one. You don't leave their bedside. What you want to do is you want to first assess their respiratory drive. Is their rate above 8 and 10? Listen over their trachea, then over their upper airways. Are they moving air down into their lungs? If they're not, then you may need to do a jaw thrust, manual chin lift, to open up that airway and reposition them. If they are not breathing, then you would need to get out your AmbuBag and bag valve mask ventilate the patient to do rescue breathing. The anesthesiologist may need to give an additional reversal at this time if they are not fully reversed. Before you even begin report, you want to make sure that your patient is breathing adequately, is perfusing adequately, and ventilating adequately before you begin with your report. Once the patient wakes up, then you can remove that oral airway. And again, in my experience, some people only need that oral airway in for a very brief period of time, like just seconds, and then they wake up upon arrival to PACU. And other patients, I recall the longest I had somebody in a deep sedation was 45 minutes with an oral airway in. So you never know what you're going to get. You need to be vigilant about monitoring that airway. And as long as somebody is in a deep state, they are a one-to-one patient. If not, two nurses to one patient, because if you have to do a manual jaw thrust with that patient, then you will need a second nurse. Laryngospasms, I'm going to be doing a video on how do you manage laryngospasms, but just briefly, when a patient does wake up and if they do go into laryngospasms, you are going to do a positive pressure ventilation with an AmbuBag, 100% FiO2, and you are calling for help to get your anesthesiologist, because if they are obstructed, you're going to have to do an emergent intubation with anesthesia. And if they are unobstructed, then you will need to do a stat racemic epi nebulizer and probably some additional maneuvers to work on opening up those vocal cords. And then if you do have a patient who is a CO2 retainer, you may need to call respiratory therapy and get a BiPAP machine, or if they have a home CPAP, once they are awake, then you can place them on their home CPAP with bleed-in oxygen to help blow off that retained CO2 and help them ventilate and breathe off those anesthesia gases. Always going to be doing your cardiovascular assessment once you've got your respiratory assessment done. And you just want to make sure that your patient is not bradycardic. When they do the reversal of the neuromuscular blocking agents, there can have some muscarinic brady effects, and glycopyrrolate works really great to counteract those effects and bringing the heart rate up nice and gently. So you will check your physician's orders on what you have to treat bradycardia. And then also, if they're hypotensive, you're going to be treating that per your orders, either fluids or phenylephrine. And then if they're hypertensive, then you'll also be following your orders, maybe doing labetalol or hydralazine for management of hypertension with reversal. And then you also always want to just evaluate their EBL, their blood loss from surgery. You know, was it excessive? Do they need replacement? Do you have products on hold on call that you could transfuse? And those are conversations that you will have with your anesthesiologist upon report. Once you have received report, the patient is stable, then you can move forward. Always going to assess your incision area immediately upon arrival, making sure they don't have any bleeding or any hematomas occurring, and that everything is clean and dry and intact. If there's any complications with that, then you are immediately calling the surgeon and addressing that and putting pressure. If they are totally obtunded, you are going to do a more focused assessment on ABCs and incision area. And then once they awake, then you can do more of a neuro assessment. You're going to be doing your baseline sedation score and Aldretti upon arrival. And then also you're going to be assessing for post-op nausea and vomit. If you have any questions about what to do during phase one, I did a video about phase. I recommend that you find that video and just review it. And then for anesthesia, after the patient has been in the PACU for some time, anesthesia will swing back through and they will do a second assessment. Some hospitals are very specific on this assessment. Some hospitals are very vague on this assessment. So your anesthesia group, get to know their practice. I have worked in places where it was a very formal sign out with an interview by the anesthesiologist with the patient, and the patient can absolutely not leave the PACU until that sign out has been completed by the provider. And then other places, it's been a very casual sign out where they just walk by, say, how you doing, ask the nurse, how's everything going? And if it's all good, then they do their sign out. So yes, get to know your physicians and your standards of practice at your hospital and your policy and procedures. But what a sign out usually entails is the surgical site stable? Is there pain control ready of 8 or higher to leave PACU? So that I have found consistent across facilities. And then post-op nausea and vomiting, usually across all the facilities, they need to have had it treated and some improvement. We're not going to be sending anyone out of the PACU who's still retching. Anesthesia, one of their sign-out questions for the patient was, did they have any recall of the surgery? And what they're assessing for is the amnesia properties of the anesthesia. If they did not have amnesia from the surgical event and they could recall things, that is a reportable event. And anesthesia definitely wants to know about it so that we can address that and avoid that in future situations. These are some of the things that anesthesia reviews on sign out. And then they will document a post-anesthesia note where they officially release the patient from their care. And you are also now able to move the patient forward through this phase of care from phase one, either into inpatient or to phase two, moving to discharge. I hope that you found this video useful in understanding general anesthesia from induction and maintenance, emergence and recovery. I hope that it gave you insight into what a deep extubation is and how would you care for that patient in the PACU, and just a greater knowledge of emergence. If you feel like I have given you value added to your practice, please ring the bell, subscribe. Thank you for tuning in to PACU Nursing Minutes. I'm Nurse Kathy.